Please turn with me to the book of Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 7, reading verses 12 to 13, verses 11 to 13. Zechariah chapter 7, verses 11 to 13. This is God speaking through his prophet, condemning the behavior of the people of Israel and explaining why they have God allowed them to go into exile. Zechariah 7, verse 11. God says, "But they refused to pay attention. Stubbornly they turned their backs and covered their ears. They made their hearts as hard as flint and would not listen to the law or to the words that the Lord Almighty had sent by his Spirit through the earlier prophets. So the Lord Almighty was very angry. When I called, they did not listen. So when they called, I would not listen, says the Lord Almighty." We thank God for the reading of his word this morning. This morning's sermon, I was trying to find something more Christian to call it, but at the end of the day, this is what the sermon is about, so this is the title. Are you the stink in your house? How do you make that more Christian? There's no equivalent in the Bible. Are you the stink in your house? And just to be correct, there's a question mark at the end of it. This past 2 weeks, I've been doing some work at home. Partly because I wanted to, secondly because, mostly because my wife made me. And I was cleaning the garage. Whole lot of tools, whole lot of stuff. Found a lot of things that I didn't know that I had. Found a few things that I thought I had lost. Found many things that don't belong to me. So I need to return a bit of stuff. Linda see me after the service. I got some of Terence's tools in my garage. And it was just a lot of stuff. Because I emptied the tool shed, I emptied the garage, and it came to a point where you couldn't just work neatly. So I took everything and just put it on the floor, on the garage floor. And it was so much that we can't park a car in the garage anymore. And everything was there on the floor, and I started to make piles. One pile is for this, one pile is for that, one pile is for this. And one of the piles was garbage. Stuff that has been accumulated over the years. Now you must know this is what my father collected before him. We are hoarders. And stuff going back maybe twice my age. And one pile was garbage. Things that no longer can be used. Things that need to be thrown away. And as I had this heap, very excited about the stuff that I found. Very excited about the things that I could use. But also excited that I was going to throw things away to make some space and to neaten things up. And as I had this heap, it occurred to me that until I find a way to get rid of this rubbish, it's still going to be there as a problem. Just identifying that it is rubbish doesn't solve anything. In fact, all I'm left with is a pile of stuff that I know is worth nothing. And so Christians are in this place in their lives where God has told you to do a cleanup. Maybe you came to church, or maybe you got a doctor's report, or maybe somebody visited you and they said something that made you think, yeah, I need to change this bad behavior or this bad habit, or I need to clean up my life a little bit. And so we start to think, we say, yes, Lord, I want to be close to you. All of us have been at that place. And as we begin to pray, God begins to reveal to us, God begins to show us all the things in our life that are not useful anymore, that are not a part of you anymore, that belong long ago in your past. And we begin to identify what is now rubbish or garbage in our lives. But we keep it there in that heap. Because we say, thank you, Lord, for bringing this to light. Thank you, Lord, for showing me that I need to change. We come to the pastor and we shake his hand and say, thank you, pastor, that word was for me. We go home and we say, I really felt conviction today that I need to change. We come home with the doctor's report and you say, yes, this is proof that I need to change. But just knowing that you need to change in itself accomplishes nothing. Because until I throw the rubbish away, it's still just a heap of rubbish in my yard, in my garage. Let me put it to you this way. Maybe you didn't clean your garage. But all of us know when bin day is. And what we do is we make sure that the bin packets are tight. And what do we do after that? We make sure we go and we leave it where they will take it away from. Just taking all your garbage and putting it in a bin bag and leaving it in your house doesn't solve anything. In fact, it makes things worse because then you know where the stink is. It's not all over in this bin, in that bin. All the rubbish is in one place. And if you leave that bin bag, say, in your passage or in the entrance to your home or somewhere that it's not going to be taken away from, you didn't solve anything. Good, you knew what was dirt. Very good, you put it in the bin bag. Very good, you moved it from one place to another. But until you put it in a place where it is gone forever, because we don't know where the garbage goes, garbage heaven. We don't know where this mystical place is, where our garbage can run free and wild. All we know is it's no longer in our home. It's no longer an issue for us. But until we put our sin, the rubbish, the garbage in our lives, the bad things that shouldn't be there, unless we identify it, collect it, and put it in a place where it can be taken away, we haven't accomplished anything. Just by the way, we're still talking about families. This is a mid-season pep talk. I felt persecuted this past week. I'll tell you a story. Because in my home cell, words were said about the pastor of the church. And just in case you didn't know, I don't preach at home cell. Somebody far greater than me preaches in home cell. So I'm told. Jeannie preaches. And she had a go at me. Can you believe that? Saying that I'm a biased preacher. Yes, Jason, me. I'm a biased preacher. I only preach for the men in the church. The women rather not come to church. The women got no salvation in this house. You all heard it wrong, you know? Because I only talk about football. And you all don't know about football. So she's speaking about shopping. So I said, I'll show you. Football is something you can understand. I'll show you. Today I'm going to teach about golf. Golf. Now, when you play the game of golf, you end up either above par or below par. Below par is good, above par is bad. And when you break even, it says you are on par. Now all of us have used that phrase. Maybe you didn't know it comes from golf. But when you come back to level, maybe you paid off a debt, or maybe you're just getting back on your feet, you say, I'm on par. It's from golf. Just getting back on par in your life doesn't mean that you are serving God. You just got out of a bad situation to level footing. It puts you in a place where you are better able to try to serve God. But unless you do that, it's not worth it. Let me put it here this way. You've come to church, you've heard that smoking is bad. You've heard that alcohol is bad. Tie it in with our series on families, mid-season pep talk. You've heard that you need to be a better husband. You've heard that you need to be a better wife. These are the things as a child that I need to change, as a parent. We need to do this as a home, as a family. I need to stop abusing my family. We've heard all of these sermons. And the Spirit convicted you because you felt as you were in church, maybe this is for me. I didn't know. I need to change. So God showed you where the rubbish is. And you went home and you thought about it and you spoke with your wife or you spoke with your parents and you said, you know what, we need to change. We need to be better as a family. Good. You collected the garbage. But if you did not take the step beyond that and make it stick and begin to actually be a better father, mother, husband, wife, parent, child, all you've done is you've got a good packet of rotting garbage sitting in your home still. Not going to get any better, because the problem we have is this. I don't know if you've ever walked around and had something in your shoe, and you walk but you're embarrassed to take your shoe off in front of people because, like me, you don't want them to see your Tom socks, or maybe your crooked toes, or maybe you didn't paint your toenails. I don't always paint my toenails when I go out. And so you carry on with that stone or whatever it is in your shoe. And eventually you get used to it so that you forget that you had a problem in the first place. That's the danger. The longer you sit with a problem in your house, and the longer you keep that problem in your house, the greater the danger that that is going to become normal for you. And you forget, you become numb to the fact that you need to get rid of that stone. You need to get rid of that bin bag. You need to get it out of your house, out of your life, out of your family. And once that becomes normal, the bar gets lower and lower and lower. That's also from sports. That's high jump. And as the bar gets lower and lower and lower, sin becomes worse and worse and worse, because normally something that's nothing good anymore. God wants you to keep a high standard. God wants you to have a clean house. Amen. You know when you walk into some people's houses and it's not clean? You think to yourself, no wonder God doesn't live in this house. I'm not saying God will only come and visit you after you have a bath, but I am saying He can only help. And you know, when you look at our spiritual lives, sometimes it's filthy. Oh, but God showed us many things and we put it in bin bags, but we're collecting bin bags. And it stinks. And let me enlighten you a little bit. See, Wesley and I live in the same house. Now, obviously, you know who's the clean one and who's the dirty one from the two of us. Now, if I take all my dirt and I take it and put it in a bin bag and I leave it in the passage, how many of you know his house stinks also? All of us don't have to be dirty enough in the home. All of us don't need to have sinful lives for our home to be dirty. I knew the stink in your house. I knew the reason why your family is not prospering, progressing, because you got the garbage, you keeping it in that house. Your whole family is going to church. That's great. Mom and Wes are taking the bin bags and leaving it on the road for the bin truck to pick it up. But are you the one who is refusing? Stubborn. I'll do it in my own time. Our bin day is Thursday. I think in audience it's Tuesday. I think for some of you, whenever you see your neighbor's bin bags outside. Oh yes, I'm supposed to do it, and you go and you leave it outside. You can't say, I'll take it out on Wednesday, because it's just going to lie. And it's going to be an embarrassment for everybody to see. The dog will come rip it up and all, we see you eating tin fish, we see you eating this, we see that, because the dog's going to let it everywhere. No, Master, we don't eat tin fish in this house. Where's your can over there? What you bought for the dog? Not your dog there. And it becomes a public embarrassment for mom and Wes also, because I said, I'm so great, the bin truck must make special trip for me, God must come specially for me at my time, at my convenience. It doesn't work like that. When the bin truck is gone, you must now find, hey, let me go leave it on the neighbor's verge. People think it's there. Most Christians have identified the problems. They know what they are doing wrong, but just haven't taken the trash out yet. It's still there. Just saying, thank you God for showing me my sin. It's a wonderful sin. Because God took the time to reveal it. Wonderful. But isn't it an insult to this God who took the time to show me? To say, yes God, thank you for showing me my sin. I'll sort it out some other time. That's wrong. If I tell you there's something on the floor, there's dirt, can you please help me pick that piece of paper and throw it in the bin? Yes, Pastor, I see that paper on the floor. I'll do it just now. What does it say? What does it say about your relationship with God? That Christians have this attitude, thank you, Lord, for conviction. I'm happy I went to church today. I'm happy that I prayed. I'm happy, Lord, that you took the time to speak to me. The God of this universe, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, spoke to you. Spoke to me. Oh, Lord, we worship you. We give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. Maybe next week I'll sort it out. Jesus took your sins away. This might sound blasphemous, but get the point. Jesus took your sins away like the bin truck took my garbage away. They did not come into my house and take it. I do not want them in my house. They did not come and take this bin, empty it into the bin packet, that bin, empty it into the bin packet, and say, okay, now we're taking your garbage away. I had to do what I had to do, and then my garbage was gone. My sins are remembered no more. But are you putting it in a place where God can deal with it? Let me tell you where the place is not. The secret in your pocket. Let me tell you where it's not. Your stash. You know the alcohol you got in the top cupboard so your children can't eat? That's not getting rid of it. You know that private pics you've got on your phone? Or those SMSs that you've got saved under another number? Or you got a different SIM card? Or your different email account? Or that person at work that your wife doesn't know about? That's not putting it in a place where God can deal with it. Somebody better receive this day, because conviction is coming. The sin, the garbage is being revealed. Now you must decide what you're going to do with it. The truth will set you free. The light of Christ will reveal what is not of God. But if you say, oh, the light's on, there's rubbish here, I'll keep it in my house. It's worth nothing. You've been hearing the word. You've been receiving the word. God has been revealing the word. Means you know the time when you say, my eyes have been opened, it was an eye-opening experience. But your house is still dirty. You can tell me you've swept as much as you want. You can tell me you mopped as much as you want. You know, we go around to homes for home sale. And it always, it's nice to see how neat the homes are. It feels good that people in our church have neat, tidy homes. Imagine if one day we go for home sale. Let's use my house as an example. If you come to my house and you say, oh, we're going for home sale, we're going to worship God. And then I say, bro, just take a seat there. Don't worry, it's a Bundexit. Sit on it. I put it there for you to sit on. No, anybody got chairs, then sure, chairs, I'm going to empty the bin and I put it there for you. How are you going to feel? Are you going to feel, why are you worshipping God and in the presence of all this stuff that stinks? Are you going to feel like you were blessed? Are you going to feel like you were edified? The work could be good. The worship could be good. The prayer could be good. But as long as there's food in your life, as long as there's food in your life, there's a hindrance to what God wants to do. Let me ask you a question. Who is better? A person in the world who sins in their ignorance, or a person in the church who sins even though they know it is wrong? Who's better? The person in the world who doesn't know Jesus and does something bad, or the person sitting in the church with a suit and tie carrying a Bible, who knows Jesus as Lord but keeps doing it? Who's better? You know, people still to this day show a lot of respect for my father. Just knowing who Kandasamy was opened many doors for me. And they show him that respect. I'm happy about that. I'm proud about it. It makes me feel good. It would mean absolutely nothing to him or to anybody else if his own sons had no respect for him. Make sense? It's more important what we as the children of God do than going and preaching to everybody outside about what they shouldn't do. The church is good at it. The Christians are good at that. We can tell everybody what they are doing wrong. It's more important what we should be doing right. And so when we see people, and we see that they don't know what they are doing is wrong because they haven't met Jesus, we cannot measure ourselves by them and say, my family is better than them because we go to church. No. Because they are not what we measure ourselves by. When God brought something to light concerning your family, because the series is going to be finished soon. We're going to put this away. I'll come back to it in a few years when more people have joined the church, new people have joined the church, and we have to go over it again. It's not something that I'm going to go over and over and over and over again. And once the series is done, we'll move on to something else, which means maybe you missed your moment. Maybe you missed your opportunity, because it will become numb again. It will become that stone in your shoe again. And you will miss what God wants to do for you. So we say, the Lord, the word into my heart today. We say the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, cutting through the meat, bones, cutting everything, getting down to the heart of the matter. Let me tell you how this works. If you would take an example from me, if I cut my hand here, it will bleed. And I'll say, what I did was wrong. I need to attend to this cut, and I need to be more careful next time. Then I do the same stupid thing, and it gets cut again. Hey, how could I do myself again? Eventually, you know what happened? It'll become calloused. It'll become hard. Which means it's not cut easily anymore. I have to put a lot of pressure until one day we can say I can poke pins in there and no blood comes. Calloused. The Bible says, make sure your heart